Hello and welcome to New Mexico's Naturopathic Medical Show. I'm Dr. Wendy Van Dilla, naturopathic physician and your host. In the studio today with me is Gerhardt Horstman, who is an Ayurvedic practitioner in Albuquerque, New Mexico. Ayurveda is the ancient science from India, and it is currently practiced. And we are very lucky in New Mexico to have Gerhardt and other Ayurvedic practitioners and a couple of Ayurvedic physicians from India that come over. And welcome again to the studio, Gerhardt.
Yeah, that is an interesting phenomenon that we have so much Ayurveda from India in New Mexico. And it's nothing to do with it, but if you look at the globe, New Mexico and India are just about equidistant from each other. So it's about as far away from India as you can possibly get. But it has all managed to find its way here.
Why do you think that?
Part of it had to do with just the destiny of Ayurveda. Dr. Lodd, who's been teaching Ayurveda for over 20 years now in the United States, actually probably over 30 years now in the United States, is originally set up here in Santa Fe, and then he moved to Albuquerque. And that created a real mecca of Ayurveda around the U.S. I mean, that was why I came to Albuquerque from Oregon, because it was really the only place to go you could learn more about Ayurveda.
Wow.
And because of that, I wound up here, and then I met the Joshis, and they wound up here a little bit because of me and also a couple other folks they knew that were working out of Santa Fe. And so, well, for whatever reason, New Mexico became a bit of a magnet for Ayurveda.
And that's unusual throughout the United States. I mean, there's a lot of Chinese medicine throughout the United States, but not so much Ayurvedic medicine.
Not very much at all, actually. I mean, Ayurveda has been more of on an educational plane in U.S., and there's schools that help teach you something about Ayurveda. You learn some principles. Ayurvedic practitioners and doctors are few and far between, and there's really not a lot of them. There's a few places that have some, but most states in the United States don't even have an Ayurvedic practitioner.
And there's a certain treatment in Ayurveda called Panchakarma. Mm-hmm. And would you explain at what point is that used in an Ayurvedic treatment or treatment plan?
It's pretty amazing stuff. The gentleman that I work with, Dr. Sunil Joshi, is well known around the world for his skills at this treatment called Panchakarma. And Panchakarma is a very thorough way of cleaning out the body. So that's really what it was designed to do. It also can help just keep the body more balanced, and it can also really help rejuvenate and build the body back up. So those three phases of Panchakarma, it's kind of what your intention is when you go about doing Panchakarma. People who are at a stage either where they're actually pretty fragile or opposite to that, extremely healthy, can benefit tremendously by getting a nice palliative treatment of simply relaxing, calming the nervous system down, getting some toxins to release, calming the mind, kind of letting those doshas, vata, pitta, kapha, to settle a little bit. And that is what Panchakarma is kind of all about. And that's happening a lot in the U.S. There's more and more places actually doing that now. You can also do Panchakarma to rejuvenate the body and build it back up. But there's an old saying in one of our old Ayurveda books that says you should never dye a cloth a nice color until you wash it first. And that was their analogy, that if you try to build the body back up without taking out the unwanted waste products and the toxins that have accumulated in the body, you're going to get limited results. So ideally, clean it out first and then rejuvenate it.
And this is a concept I really appreciate about Ayurvedic medicine. And it is in other traditional forms of medicine. But I teach pathophysiology up at Northern New Mexico College in Española, and none of the Western textbooks that I see emphasize elimination. It's mentioned, but when I write my holistic pathophysiology book, I'm going to have a whole chapter on the system of elimination and detoxification.
Panchakarma is extremely unique in its understanding of that, too. I mean, it goes back to the Ayurvedic concept of doshas, and there's these three doshas, vata, pitta, kapha, and they're kind of the intelligence of the body.
Wait a minute. So the three doshas are constitutional types?
They're constitutional types, but they're more functional. in their definition. They look at one dosha, Vata dosha, as having this job of movement. So anytime you see movement in the physiology, that's Vata's job. And that governs pretty much all of our stuff, circulation, respiration, digestion, elimination, anything where there's movement. The fire component, Pitta dosha, does transformation. So that links into our system of metabolism. Mm-hmm. Ayurveda has a very broad definition and understanding of how metabolism works in all the tissues. So they emphasize metabolism a lot because we know we have to transform our food in order to get it into the cells of our body. Mm-hmm. And finally, this concept of the kapha dosha is all about rejuvenation, cohesion, sticking everything back together. Kapha is that watery element of who we are, and we all know we're 70% water. So there's a lot of kapha going on inside of our body.
It's also the structural part.
And it's the structural part. And we're always rejuvenating our structures. New cells are dying, new cells are being born all the time. That's kapha's job, to do that rejuvenation. And all three of these doshas work together. They don't really separate. However, you'll find Vata everywhere because it does movement. You'll find Pitta more in this zone of the body because it does transformation, and that's where our digestion takes place. Mm-hmm. And you'll find Kapha in more of the soft tissues and more of the places where you're going to find more plasma, more nutrient fluid, or just more muscle, more fat. Those are more Kapha areas. Mm-hmm. In the GI tract, they give them specific homes. And they say the Kapha lives up here because that's where all the secretions are, where all the watery secretions are, and Kapha has water in it. Mm-hmm. And the Pitta lives in the middle because that's where all the transformation digestion happens. Mm-hmm. And the Vata lives in the colon because that's where absorption happens and movement happens. Now, when we do Panchakarma, that's exactly what we're doing. We're trying to get to these three doshas. And mm-hmm. if they live inside the GI tract, we have to go inside the GI tract to get to them.
So a Panchakarma, talk through, like, if somebody's mm-hmm. preparing for a Panchakarma, mm-hmm. What would they do?
There's three parts to Panchakarma, and the preparing phase is a lot of oil massage and a lot of steam treatments, a lot of heat therapies. The idea behind that is when you put oil on the body, we absorb it readily. We absorb lipids, and those go into our cells. And the cells do this lovely thing called osmosis, which we all learned back in high school biology.
Let me step in here. That's one thing I love about Ayurveda, mm-hmm. is you can actually absorb oils not through the diet, in addition to the digestive system,
right.
directly through your
outside,
skin.
From the outside in. And that's why we cook herbs into our oils, because the herbs go in along with the oil. Incredible stuff.
So it's using the skin as an absorption.
But I mean, one of the primary functions of oil is actually it makes the body have more secretions. They use a word in Sanskrit, vishandan, but it just simply means secretions. And this goes back to osmosis, where the cell actually absorbs oil, and because the intercellular pressure gets bigger, it has to push something through the cell wall in order to balance the pressure outside and in. And what comes out is mostly cytoplasm fluid, but it has unwanted little things in it, like maybe lactic acid, maybe you're getting some cramping, maybe it's something else, maybe it's some other toxin from a food. It could be substance you got from breathing bad air, drinking bad water, who knows?
Smoking or
all those things.
Pollution.
And once that gets back into circulation in the body, it has an opportunity to get back to the GI tract, hopefully come out with the waste products. Mm-hmm. This is the theory of Panchakarma.
So when
do this oiling up, do this heating thing to get this stuff moving. That's the most important first phase of Panchakarma, is you have to get stuff moving. And that takes mm-hmm. a little bit of time. In Albuquerque, we do 7 days in a row of therapies. In India, we do anywhere from 7 days to 42 days in a row of therapies, depending on what your condition is and what you're there for. So it's not something where you can just put some oil on your body and this will happen. It's something that has to happen over time and in a consecutive manner.
So you really have to like dedicate part of your life to going through this process.
We ask people to take 8 days off to be with us, and then we also encourage them to take at least a few days off afterwards to be by themselves and to ease back into their food and ease back into their lifestyle.
This is similar to like some of the old-fashioned naturopathic treatments in Europe, where you go to a place for healing.
You know, they still do that, though, Wendy, in Europe. I wish they would do that here.
Well, here we do it more as a cosmetic, as a vacation, as a spa type thing.
Yeah, there they build it into the work week. I mean, they get every other Friday off to go to the mud baths or to go to the massage place.
Really?
Or to just go take a hike in the hills. It's actually part of their of their social structure. It's a big thing in Germany and Switzerland and Austria for people to get out and do alternative therapies.
Well, that sounds fantastic.
Yeah, we should all move there.
Bring it here.
Or bring it here.
So yeah, that's another thing that I think a lot of people in America think of Panchakarma as being something that's easy and relaxing and pleasurable to go through. And
parts of it are. Parts of it are, but when you're doing a lot of cleansing, stuff comes up. And it comes up not just on a physical level, it comes up on a spiritual level, an emotional level. And depending on what stuff you've been hanging on to, it typically will surface during a Panchakarma. 7 days, not as much as when you're there for a whole month. If you're there for a whole month, guaranteed you're going to have days where stuff comes up. We're pretty used to it, so it doesn't faze us. We don't take it personal, but I mean, it seems like it's almost part of the process that you are going to have moments of tremendous bliss, tremendous sorrow, body ache. You might be nauseous. You might be going to the bathroom half a dozen times that night. This is all quite possible.
So yeah,
Panchakarma.
I think modern people are pretty disgusted by their excretions and by their discharges, and this process is using them as a vehicle to clean, to detox.
Not only that, but on the seventh night, we give you special herbs that even accelerate that process more.
Oh, and, what do you mean?
And we actually ask you to pay attention and write down what's coming out. Okay, because you know I mean this is an interesting story about Dr. Joshi, but when he was in medical school, okay. One of the nicknames the kids would tease him about was called Malacharya, which simply meant he knew everything about the malas, the waste products.
The malas.
But his mentor, this great clinician, Dr. Cotty, always told him you have to check what's coming out of the body. If you don't know what's coming out of the body, you don't know what's going on inside the GI tract. And that became a common practice for him. If he couldn't get his clients to do it, he would literally ask them to bring a sample in, and mm-hmm. he would check it himself. And so this business of what comes in the body as well as what goes out the body is almost the cornerstone of Ayurvedic management. We're always looking at balancing what we call prana, which is what brings everything in, mm-hmm. with apan, which takes everything out. When those two are working in coordination, you're pretty healthy.
So a true Panchakarma treatment involves purging, and which means causing diarrhea, mm-hmm. and vomiting.
That's upsetting the stomach. One of them too. I mean, that's what we call the main procedures of Panchakarma, the pradhan karmas. And pancha means five, and karma means to have an action. So in ancient India, they were the five actions. Now, when Panchakarma was first codified, what they did with the five actions is they used enema as two different actions. They looked at enemas as either being nutritive or cleansing. So mm-hmm. those were two of them. Nausea treatment is a treatment for the sinuses. That was one of the karmas. And then virachan, which is the purgation. And then vamana, which is therapeutic vomiting. About 500 years later, another scholar of Ayurveda, Shashrut, he really got involved in blood. He thought blood was a really important part of who we are, which it is. So he brought in another therapy called bloodletting, Rakta Moksha, and that became the fifth karma, and they combined the two animas as one karma. And if you read a book on Panchakarma today, that's probably what they'll reference as the five karmas. But originally, Panchakarma was more about cleaning out the colon, cleaning out the small intestine, cleaning out the stomach, cleaning out the sinus passages. Those were the four areas that you were addressing. And this was more about the whole head area and that prana that you need to get coming in better. This was more about getting the kapha out in the stomach, therapeutic vomiting, purgation for the small intestine, pitta dosha, and basti or enemas for the colon, for vata dosha.
Okay, and we've got a lovely example of one of the tools of Panchakarma right here.
It's a Shiradhara pot, yes it is.
Shiradhara.
Uh-huh.
When in Panchakarma would this be used?
We use it in Albuquerque pretty much every day. It's a very relaxing treatment. It works specifically on that type of vata called prana that brings everything in, and it works in our mental facility. And everyone needs
our overused facility.
Our overused mental facility. And the very typical response for this is people will go to sleep, they'll kind of drift off. It's like a meditation without actually having to try to sit and quiet your mind.
So what goes into the pot?
We use a sesame oil for all of our oils, but we cook various herbs in it. Now for this treatment, because it's going on the brain, we use a lot of nervine herbs, things like gota kola, we call Brahmi, jatamamsi, valerian, those kind of herbs that are mm-hmm. very relaxing and calming for the mind. Mm-hmm. If we're doing it on the body, we may put something else into that to make it either a little more heating or a little more cooling, depending on our effect. And mm-hmm. India literally has hundreds of oils. I mean, they have a specific oil for just about everything. And they're all infused with herbs, which is really a wonderful process. I'm involved in that in Albuquerque. I'm always making oil because our clients love this stuff, and it's an ongoing process of cooking the herbs down, making a nice decoction, adding the oil, cooking that down until you have the final product.
Other than sesame, what base oils do you use?
We don't use a whole lot. Sesame has this amazing property called tikshna. Tikshna means penetration. Mm-hmm. And it penetrates better than any other oil. So in the old text, they said you could use certain oils for certain applications, like mm-hmm. mustard oil is great to heat up a joint. It can make like a great tiger balm effect, mm-hmm. but you don't use mustard oil on the whole body. That would be way too hot. And sesame was the oil they always recommended as using. Now, we don't just use sesame oil by itself for virtually anything. We were always cooking herbs in, so we have a lot of varieties as to what type of sesame oil preparation we're going to use. But sesame is the base oil in Ayurveda. And now, why they mm-hmm. chose that one, I think, was just because of that penetration quality. It will take the herbs deeper into the tissues.
Well, ghee is used a lot, medicinal ghee.
Yeah, ghee is also used. That's more of a nutritive substance. And we use that both externally and internally. Part of Panchakarma is to take a little bit of ghee with bitter herbs in it, because that helps everything kind of mm-hmm. clean out in the GI tract.
And for those of our audience that don't know what ghee is.
Yeah, ghee is famous in French cooking, but they call it clarified butter. And it's really great stuff. I mean, we recommend it a lot as part of your nutritional regimen, because when you take butter and you prepare it into ghee, you cook out most of the bad milk solids and everything that you don't want anyway, because that makes your cholesterol go up and all that stuff. And even though when it cools down, it looks like butter a little bit, but when it's warm, it looks like oil. Mm-hmm. And it has a much different effect on the body. It actually promotes metabolism, providing you don't go overboard with it and use too much. Whereas butter tends to actually suppress your metabolism because it's hard to digest.
Is that because of the milk solids in it?
Yeah.
Well, in cooking, there's a lot of techniques to make dairy more digestible.
Right. I mean, they put ginger root sometimes in their warm milk at night, or they put cardamom in there. Personally, my experience, I go to India a lot, and in India they haven't messed up the agribusiness within the dairy industry as much as we have. And the dairy I get in India, I digest fine. The dairy I get in the United States can be a little bit harder sometimes. We do things to it like ultra-pasteurizing and homogenizing, which just makes it harder to digest.
So in India you can get raw?
Oh yeah, the cows get milked about 4 a.m, and then most farms turn them loose because the Indian custom is to always feed a cow the next day your leftovers. So that's why in Ayurveda we say don't eat leftovers, because the cow already ate the leftovers. But they literally turn their cows loose and they wander all through the streets and they go to different people's houses because they know who has the best leftovers. But in the morning they milk them all and they come to your door like they used to in America years ago with these little bags of milk. And every day you get fresh milk.
Wow.
Yeah.
Even in the cities.
Now there's more buffalo milk now in the cities. It's getting harder and harder because the cities have expanded and there's no place for the cows to live anymore.
Mm. Yeah, so they're going through some great transitions. So the Panchakarma treatments, mm-hmm. there's some heating. First, lots of oil
and then lots of heating. And then different herbs that you're taking and a special diet that you're eating. And all this is just to get you ready to really clean things out. But you are cleaning things out that whole week. While this is going on, you're definitely cleaning things out. And then on that last day, the doctor will decide what type of eliminative therapy would be best for you. And typically the two that we do a lot of would either be the coming out this way, the therapeutic vomiting, which we do in India, or coming out the other way with the purgation, and that's what we do in Albuquerque. And we do that in India as well.
And only with doctor supervision?
Only with doctor supervision.
Because that's if the person needs special tuning up.
Well, when you're doing Panchakarma to calm things down, that's not such a big deal. You're probably going to be fine and people are going to do great. When you're doing Panchakarma to clean the body out, it's definitely hard stuff to go through, and people might feel a little lightheaded, or they just might be having some anxiety, or or their emotional stuff comes up. It becomes a much bigger thing to manage, and that's why we always make sure the doctor's in the house, because he is the expert.
Like you said, during a cleansing panchakarma, things come up.
You know, if they don't, I'm probably not doing my job, Wendy.
So you also said there was some dough treatments.
Yeah, those are wonderful things, and we use those outside of panchakarma. I mean, I could get a job at a pizza parlor. I've done so many dough treatments, but what
but
it
you're
involves
not making a food.
Well, I mean, what it involves is building a donut around a part of your body, and so that the skin's actually exposed and there's just a wall. So there's like a circle in the middle, and depending where you're working, if it's on your neck, it's a smaller circle. If it's on your low back, it's a pretty big circle. Mm-hmm. And then we heat up special medicated oils just for that treatment. We pour the oil in there, and it can sit there for 15, 20 minutes until we take it out.
And that's called a basti.
That's called a basti.
When oil is sitting.
It's actually sitting in one place. And then they'll attach a name to that based on the anatomy. So if it's a kadi basti, that's your low back, sacrum area. If it's a manya basti, it's on your neck. If it's an uro basti, it's on your heart, on your chest. Netra bastis are on your eyes. And so they have different applications for this, and they'll use different substances. Typically, you don't put oil in the eyes, you put ghee in the eyes. And on the other parts of the body, we tend to use oil more, and different oils as well, and different ghees also. And so that way you can kind of gear it to different places where you want to apply it. But we have a lot of low back issues in our culture. We sit a lot, and and a lot of people have stiff necks, and those two areas in particular I've seen incredible results doing these dough treatments. Just, you might have to do them more than once, but I mean, after a couple of seatings, it loosens up, the soft tissue starts to loosen up, and that typically is what's holding those vertebrae and making them compress. So if you can get not just a massage, but actually get some of these dough treatments, we've seen great results in low back and neck stuff.
So you've got a pool of oil
sitting over
a problem area.
Right, and of course you have to be still for those 20 minutes, and you can't get up and dance, but that's how it goes.
Well, that's a therapy in itself.
It's just relaxing
for 20 minutes. What other specialty Ayurvedic bodywork is there?
They use a lot of, I mean, a lot of the different heating therapies are interesting. One of them they like to do for nutritive purposes is to take milk and cook herbs into milk. Milk has milk fat, so you want to use whole milk. And the milk fat works like an oil, like a snehan. It takes these herbs into the tissues. One of the great ones they call pinda suede, because you put it on with a rice ball that you've cooked in other herbs and tied in a cloth. And I've seen incredible results for neuromuscular diseases using that treatment.
So this isn't eating it. This is
applying
it.
No, this is externally, yeah.
So using the cooked milk
and putting
applying
on hot
it on
milk
the outside
and giving them like a sponge bath with the rice ball. It's very messy, which is why we have to build special tables to carry out most of these therapies. This probably wouldn't be something you'd want to do on a portable massage table.
No, because it would
be a mess.
So you have a specialty table so that you can clean easily.
Well, it has a little drain channel, actually, so that it collects all this stuff and drains it into a pot. Because we use probably about half a gallon of liquid when we do one of these hot milk treatments. And
so
it's pretty neat stuff.
And you use homogenized milk for that?
Pasteurized
homogenized?
We like getting the stuff with cream on the top, but sometimes you can't. But most important is that you don't want to use 2% or skim milk with that, because it's the milk fat that actually works. That's the active ingredient.
And most Americans are scared to death of cream and milk fat.
Well, you get on your body, though. It's great. Cleopatra used to get milk baths, so it's like being queen for a day.
That's one thing I really appreciate about Ayurveda is they're bringing back the importance of healthy fats and healthy oils.
That's very important.
We absolutely
very
need
important.
Them for our health.
Yeah, yeah. We always tell people, eat some fat, have some ghee, use olive oil. And they look at us like, really? And we're like, yeah, really. Because, you know, what lubricates your joints? I mean, you need lubrication in your body. And you get that internally with oil. Don't go nuts with it. Don't go with the deep fried foods and stuff. But when you cook your spices in your pan, you're going to put a little butter or ghee or oil in there. You don't need a lot, but you need some.
Well, if anybody needs convincing about this subject, Sally Fallon and Mary Enig did an amazing video called The Oiling of America that I want to promote. And it goes over, Sally's doing a talk just on how we were convinced to, in our country, in America, to switch to vegetable oils, and they demonized the animal fats, which is creating so many different health problems.
A lot of the vegetable oils, they might be good on salads, but when they get heated, they aren't necessarily healthy for the body, and that's where the problem is starting to come in.
Absolutely. Yeah. And you also do seminars in Albuquerque where you teach people about Ayurvedic medicine and do some Panchakarma treatments, or your seminars are also about Vata management.
Yeah, I mean, I've been focusing personally on teaching more about the real basic stuff, how to cook good food for yourself, how to understand the basic Ayurvedic principles so you can apply them in your own life. There is a shortage of Ayurvedic doctors and practitioners in America. You're basically, even if you are lucky enough to see Dr. Joshi or someone, you're still left your own devices a lot. You gotta be able to figure out the model. So that's where I put a lot of my emphasis in, and people come to me for the body work, for the treatments, which we call Vata management, because it's not really Panchakarma, but it's calming down that one dosha that runs the whole show. And if you can calm Vata down, even your Pitta and Kapha get happier and your whole body works better. And the best treatment for Vata really is a nice oil massage. So I do a lot of those. Now Dr. Joshi and I hook up and we train students in India every year. And that's more to become a practitioner and actually learn how to do these treatments, how to do these therapies, all these different heating therapies, these dough treatments, all this great stuff. They're still not being taught how to do Panchakarma, but they're being taught how to do Vata management. And in India, I mean, my first experience over there, I'm going to study with this guy. I know he's number one in Panchakarma. I show up at his clinic, and there's literally, I think Pravin worked on 22 people that day. That's how busy it was. Body work. I mean, Pravin's amazing body worker. Kid's incredible. So I ask him, I said, Pravin, my God, you got 22 people here. And he goes, yeah, but only two of them are doing Panchakarma. And I was like, what do you mean? And he goes, no, people come here all the time for regular body work. It's not Panchakarma. And then I got it, that there's a difference. It looks the same, same treatment maybe, but you might be coming in just for a low back treatment. You might be coming in for a sinus treatment. You might be coming in for a full body massage. This is really how Ayurveda has been used in India for thousands of years. It's never made it over here. What you see mostly in our side of the planet is people that do Panchakarma, but you can't go somewhere and just get a nice massage. So we're trying to train people in India to do that more and send them back to their communities and let them start getting established doing that. We have some folks up and running, even a couple here in New Mexico. We have some others in Hawaii, US, Europe, Singapore, other parts of the world that have gone through our trainings the last 10 years. And that's what Dr. Joshi and I do when we really train Vata management in India. And that's a 1 month program, so that's a little more intensive.
Well, this has been an incredible introduction to Ayurveda, Vata management, what Panchakarma is. And please go to Gerhardt, the how do you say that?
It's a mouthful.
The Vinayak Ayurveda.com website for more information. You've been watching New Mexico's Naturopathic Medical Show. Thank you so much for coming on the show, Gerhardt.
Thank you, Wendy.
And for those of you interested in more Ayurveda, look it up. It's a fascinating medical science. Thank you for watching.